In a previous video, we discussed the idea that National Socialism was a religion. And I'm going to assume that you've already watched that video because this video is a direct follow-up to that one, so I'll leave the link in the description if you haven't seen it. In that video, many of you were convinced by the argument I presented, but I didn't feel like I had enough time to really provide sufficient evidence to solidify it. I did provide some, but in my opinion, not enough. So that's the goal of today's video. I want to give you a lot more evidence for Hitler being religious, and specifically Gnostic. Let's start off simple with a quick reminder of what the theory is. National Socialism is a variant of Gnosticism, which is the idea that man can receive divine knowledge, gnosis, from the true God who is above the evil demiurge. The idea is that once you have divine revelation, you can transcend the prison of the materialist reality created by the demiurge and reach God. But this idea later evolved to say that a select brotherhood of Gnostics could create heaven on earth by leading a portion of mankind in the overcoming of our materialist ways. For Hitler and the National Socialists, the Jews were seen as the products of the demiurge, sent to devour the other nations of the earth, as Hitler put it. Hitler said that the Aryans had to fight this mortal enemy in order to survive and gain salvation, which would take the form of a thousand-year Reich. That is obviously a very brief summary, and if you want the full explanation, check out the previous video. But I now want to give more quotes from Hitler himself, in addition to the ones I gave last time, to further support this theory. I'm going to take some from Mein Kampf, his speeches, and from the table talks, as controversial as that might be, so we can see that there's a convergence of evidence for this idea. Let's start with Mein Kampf.
On this planet of ours, human culture and civilization are indissolubly bound up with the presence of the Aryan. If he should be exterminated or subjugated, then the dark shroud of a new barbarian era would enfold the earth.
Just to explain this, he says elsewhere that only Aryans can create nations. So, without the Aryan, the logic goes, there would be no civilization, and that's why he's concluding that there would be a barbarian era.
To undermine the existence of human culture by exterminating its founders and custodians would be an execrable crime in the eyes of those who believe that the folk idea lies at the basis of human existence. Whoever would dare to raise a profane hand against the highest image of God among his creatures would sin against the bountiful creator of his marvel and would collaborate in the expulsion from paradise.
Let's just stop there a second. So Hitler is saying that the Aryan is the highest image of God among God's creatures, and that trying to stop the Aryan would be a sin against the bountiful creator. Since the Aryans are the only ones who can create nations, apparently, such a sin against the Aryan would force humanity out of paradise. At the very least then, Aryans are linked with God and purity, and really they're painted as almost angels on earth. And all this sounds very Gnostic to me.
Hence, the folk concept of the world is in profound accord with nature's will, because it restores the free play of the forces which will lead the race through stages of sustained reciprocal education towards a higher type, until finally the best portion of mankind will possess the earth and will be free to work in every domain all over the world, and even reach spheres that lie outside the earth.
So, the concept of the folk, the people, is in alignment with nature's will, the true God?
The Aryan will go through several stages and reach a higher type, or a new man, a transcendent man, and will rule the earth. I mean, this is not only a divine prediction of the future, there's no way he could know any of this for certain unless God told him,
but also it's a clear indication that Hitler did actually want to take over the world. He says that the Aryan would dominate the Earth, and also spheres outside it. Now, he doesn't say planets, although that is implied, but he could also be suggesting a transcendence beyond our plane of existence. It certainly sounds like it to me, but I guess that's up for debate. The point still stands though that it's Gnosticism.
We all feel that in the distant future, man may be faced with problems which can be solved only by a superior race of human beings, a race destined to become master of all the other peoples, and which will have at its disposal the means and resources of the whole world.
Again, he wants to dominate the world, and he's predicting the future. But of course, There's no way to know that if he assembled the Aryans, that they would be able to take over the world and then reach a higher type. I mean, how does he know that? That's not science. He can only know that via gnosis, divine revelation. And if you can't predict the weather, then you can't predict a thousand-year Reich or heaven on earth. And yet that's exactly what he's doing. This is precisely what all the other Gnostic heresies and denominations did prior to this point. So this is Gnosticism. And earlier in Mein Kampf he says this.
"He, the Jew, will stop at nothing. His utterly low-down conduct is so appalling that one really cannot be surprised if, in the imagination of our people, the Jew is pictured as the incarnation of Satan and the symbol of evil."
Last time I also quoted him describing the Jews as satanically seducing German girls, and I'll give you another quote of him saying that in a while. And so there is a clear indication here that the Aryans are being set up as angel-like figures, while Jews are seen as devils. At the very least then, Hitler paints life as a struggle between good and evil, light and dark, an almighty creator and the devil or demiurge. And as anyone who's read Mein Kampf will probably know, we could be here all day quoting Hitler's religious passages because it's full of this stuff. There's so much of it that I'm struggling to decide what to show you. So while Mein Kampf presents itself as a political biography, in reality, it's religious scripture. And there's a reason for that. Houston Stuart Chamberlain was one of the pioneers of the Volkisch movements, which later led to the Nazi movement. His book, The Foundations of the 19th Century, massively influenced Hitler. Hitler actually mentions Chamberlain in Mein Kampf as well as in his table talks, saying that Chamberlain wrote to Hitler when he was in prison. And this isn't surprising because large passages of Mein Kampf are basically Chamberlain's words rewritten in Hitler's own way. It's almost plagiarism at times because they're that close. And Hitler gives voice to Chamberlain's ideas in his table talks and his speeches as well, so this guy is pretty important. Chamberlain is openly religious, much more blatantly than Mein Kampf is, and people have called him a radical Christian. But it's not your typical Christianity. In my opinion, it's Gnosticism, and I'll prove that in a second. And Chamberlain spends much of the book preaching this religion. He says that Christ wasn't Jewish, which Hitler also says in the table talks.
"The probability that Christ was no Jew, that he had not a drop of genuine Jewish blood in his veins, is so great that it is almost equivalent to a certainty. Jesus was most certainly not a Jew. The Jews would never have handed one of their own people to the Roman courts. They would have condemned him themselves. It is quite probable that a large number of the descendants of the Roman legionaries, mostly Gauls, were living in Galilee, and Jesus was probably one of them. His mother may well have been a Jewess. Jesus fought against the materialism of his age, and therefore against the Jews."
Hitler said the same thing on the 21st of October 1941, and Himmler also said that Jesus was not Jewish, as did others in the Nazi movement. So there is a clear lineage between Chamberlain's ideas and Hitler plus Nazi ideology. Apparently Hitler attended Chamberlain's funeral in 1927. And why is all this important? Well, Chamberlain shows us that it's Gnosticism. Chamberlain says that the Aryans had a cult of nature, and that Christ, who wasn't Jewish, became aware of this.
"Thanks to this peculiar historical sense of the Jews, Christ awoke to consciousness as far as possible from the all-embracing Aryan cult of nature, where all creation was but for man, and all men but for this one chosen people. That is, he awoke in the direct presence of God and divine providence." In other words, Christ was Gnostic. So let's just unpack this. Chamberlain makes clear that Christ was Aryan, and thus was able to awake to consciousness, which means he was touched by the true God. And this was done because of the Aryan cult of nature, or natural struggle. This next bit is a little more complicated. He says that all creation was but for man, so there's a difference between the material prison world and man. But then he says, this includes all men, but for this one chosen people, the Jews. So the Jews are the exception because they're materialists, whereas the rest of humanity is not, apparently. That's why Christ awoke in the direct presence of God and divine providence.
So, tying it all together and summarizing it as simply as possible, Chamberlain says that the material realm and the materialist Jews are different to normal men, and upon realizing this, thanks to the Aryan cult of nature, Christ was awoken to God and divine revelation.
So Chamberlain is making it clear that Christ was only able to have divine revelation because he was, supposedly, Aryan. Then he goes on to say that the Jews were materialists and that theirs was the most materialistic religion in the world. Well, anti-materialism is at the heart of Gnosticism. So this is a Gnostic heresy, and it directly influences Hitler. And if it wasn't clear before, yeah, this is a direct connection with Gnosticism. Now there's a lot more in here, but one of the things that Chamberlain explains is that each race has its own personality, and thus its own nature, and that nature is determined by the purity of each race's blood. That would explain why each race was different, why each nation was different as well, and why there were multiple competing races in a struggle. Well, this exact idea is also in Mein Kampf.
The state is a community of living beings who have kindred physical and spiritual natures, organized for the purpose of assuring the conservation of their own kind and to help towards fulfilling those ends which Providence has assigned to that particular race or racial branch.
But it's not just in Mein Kampf. In Hitler's speeches, Hitler mentions the word Providence about 500 times. In his speech on the Day of National Labour, the 1st of May 1933, the day before he supposedly crushed the trade unions, no, he nationalized them, he said this:
"We want to work and we will work. However, in the end, everything depends on the German Volk itself, on you, on the confidence you place in us. It depends on the force of your belief in the national state. Only when you all unite in the single will to save Germany will the German individual be able to find his salvation in Germany. We know that we still have tremendous difficulties to overcome. We also know that all human labors are doomed to fail if they are not blessed by the light of Providence. But we do not belong to those who comfortably rely on a hereafter. Nothing will be given us for free."
So they don't belong to those who comfortably rely on a hereafter, meaning they're not Christians or anyone else like that. And this isn't in the table talks, this is in his speeches. He goes on after this to say that they're going to continue their struggle and that they will have to work to earn their existence. But when he says that all human labors are doomed to fail if they are not blessed by the light of Providence, this is a huge clue about his Gnosticism. In National Socialism, life is a struggle between competing different races, so to Hitler, the true God, Providence, is only going to bless those of the highest race. It's not going to bless those of the lower races, which is why, supposedly, others are doomed to fail. So this whole section is basically confirmation that Hitler does believe in a higher power for Aryans only, and that this also isn't the Christian God, because the Christian God doesn't bless you depending on your supposed race. You don't become Christian because you've got the magic blood. You're Christian because you have got faith in God. So this is a totally different kettle of fish.
"My German Volksgenossen, people's comrades, the fact that the world is so against us is all the more reason why we must become a unified whole. They will no longer be able to wipe out the cry for equal rights in our Volk."
Oh, what's that? Hitler is for equal rights. Yeah, he is, Marxist. Cry more.
"The German Volk has come to its senses. It will no longer tolerate people in its midst who are not for Germany. We want to earn the renewed assent of the nation by honest means, through our industry, our persistence, our unshakable will. We are not asking of the Almighty Lord make us free. We want to take an active part, to work, to accept one another as brothers, and unite in a common struggle so that one day the hour will come when we can step before the Lord and have the right to ask of him, 'Lord, you can see that we have changed. The German Volk is no longer a Volk of infamy, shame, self-reproach, faint-heartedness, and little faith. No, Lord, the German Volk is once again strong in its will, strong in its persistence, strong in bearing any sacrifice. Lord, we will not give you up. Now bless our fight for our freedom, and thus our German Volk und Fatherland.
Wait. Let's just read that a bit again. The German Volk is no longer a Volk of infamy, shame, self-reproach, faint-heartedness, and little faith. Well, hold on. Germany was predominantly Christian back then. In fact, it's still mostly Christian now. So how can it have little faith? And the reason why is because this isn't the Christian God he's speaking about. That's the false God. He's referring to the true God of the Aryans, who's above the Demiurge. But it's very easy to be mistaken by this and assume he means the Christian God, which is why so many people have come to the conclusion that he's a Christian.
Also, this passage shows that he's trying to get the Germans to be better, either through struggle or work or sacrifice, but also purity of blood. So that one day the hour will come when they step before the Lord and tell him that they're not like they used to be. They have transcended, which is as clear as day, that is the goal of Gnosticism.
In a speech in 1936, he said, "My German Volksgenossen, people's comrades, we have a great deal to rectify before our own history and before our eternal Lord. Providence had withdrawn its protection from us. Our Volk had fallen, plunging to a depth to which a Volk has rarely fallen before. In this difficult plight, we have once again learned how to pray. We have learned to respect our Lord. We have regained our faith in the virtues of a Volk and have endeavoured to be better again. Hence a new community evolved." So it's not the Christian God because there were plenty of Christians in Germany before. Now they've learned how to pray and respect the Lord again, which they obviously weren't doing beforehand, even though they were all Christian. So again, further evidence that this isn't Christianity. "Today's Volk can no longer be compared with the Volk which lies behind us. It has become more decent, better. And we feel that the Lord is now slowly beginning to show his mercy once again." Hitler thinks that through struggle and sacrifice, he's pulling the Volk up to a new level. The higher it goes, the closer it gets to God, because again, he's aiming for transcendence. "And in this hour, let us fall down upon our knees and beg the Almighty to grant us the strength to prevail in the struggle for freedom and the future and the honour and the peace of our Volk. So help us, God."
Now maybe the comeback here is that, well, these are public speeches and written texts that were full of propaganda, so maybe he's just saying this stuff to appeal to Christians, when in reality he doesn't believe any of this. But there are two problems with that. One, he might appeal to Christians with this type of speech about God, but it's not the same God. So the propaganda is actually that he's tricking them into thinking he's talking about their God, when in reality he's talking about his own God. Secondly, why would he care to do this in 1936, when he's already firmly established? He continues to mention Providence and the Lord and the Almighty throughout his speeches, all the way up until 1945. Why would he do that if he didn't believe in it? In 1945, anyone who stepped out of line was killed, so he has no reason to actually invoke the Almighty at that point, unless he truly believes in it. So there is a consistency throughout his writings and his speeches that actually goes back, you know, before he was even on the scene. It goes back to Hubert Stuart Chamberlain and earlier too. So I don't think we can just dismiss this as little more than propaganda. It appears to be inherent within the doctrine. But in addition to this, we also have his private conversations in the form of the Table Talks. Now, some people will claim that the Table Talks are a bad source and shouldn't be used. And I've been over this before, but no, I completely disagree. The people pushing that narrative are the fanatical anti-Christians, because the Table Talks completely destroy their argument. But as I've explained, if we were to throw out the Table Talks, we'd have to throw out every memoir, and like 90% of the other sources too. And I'm not willing to do that. Yes, it's not a stenographic record of what Hitler said, but that's fine, because while Hitler may not have said these exact words, the general idea of what he said is preserved in this record.
"The religion fabricated by Paul of Tarsus, which was later called Christianity, is nothing but the communism of today. The reason why the ancient world was so pure, light and serene was that it knew nothing of the two great scourges, the pox and Christianity. Christianity is a prototype of Bolshevism, the mobilization by the Jew of the masses of slaves with the object of undermining society. Thus, one understands that the healthy elements of the Roman world were proof against this doctrine.
So it's easy to understand why anti-Christians are against the table talks, because in numerous sections, Hitler links Christianity with the Jews and Marxism, etc., which are all things he wants to destroy. So obviously, if you're trying to condemn Nazism as a Christian movement, this source completely shatters that idea. However, we don't even need the table talks in order to undermine the Hitler was a Christian argument. In Mein Kampf, Hitler calls the Catholic Church dogmatic and in conflict with science. Then later he says this:
"The pestilential adulteration of the blood, of which hundreds of thousands of our people take no account, is being systematically practiced by the Jew today. Systematically, these N-word parasites in our national body corrupt our innocent fair-haired girls and thus destroy something which can no longer be replaced in this world."
See, I told you I would provide another quote of him saying that.
"The two Christian denominations, Catholic and Protestant, look on with indifference at the profanation and destruction of a noble and unique creature, the Aryan, who was given to the world as a gift of God's grace. For the future of the world, however, it does not matter which of the two triumphs over the other, the Catholic or the Protestant, but it does matter whether Aryan humanity survives or perishes."
So it's not a question of Catholics or Protestants. What matters to Hitler is the Aryan. That, in itself, is not what you would hear a Catholic or Protestant say. He also says that they should stop the infighting and fight the Jews instead. Again, not what you expect from a Catholic or Protestant. So we don't need the table talks to prove whether Hitler was or wasn't a Christian, because he makes this clear in Mein Kampf as well as elsewhere. But because he invokes God or the Almighty Creator several times in there as well, people have assumed he's talking about the Christian God. But with our understanding of Gnosticism, we can see that that's a false assumption. And yes, there's more to it than what he just said, but the Hitler was a Christian argument falls flat when you take the time to actually look at the evidence.
And let's just look at this bit again. "The two Christian denominations look on with indifference at the profanation and destruction of a noble and unique creature who was given to the world as a gift of God's grace." Well, hold on. He's saying that the Christians are wrong, but yet he says that the Aryans are given to the world by God. That's a contradiction until you realize that Hitler's not of the same faith.
He's able to invoke God at the same time as bash the Christians. And the reason why is because he's not a Christian. He's of a different faith. But the anti-Christians are not seeing that because they haven't considered the idea that he might be a Gnostic. And even though Hitler criticizes the Christians and their churches, and even says at one point in the table talks that he defended the idea that the Nazi Party should hold itself aloof from religion, he also affirms God's existence and invokes Providence.
"Providence has endowed living creatures with a limitless fecundity, but she has not put in their reach without the need for effort on their part all the food they need. All that is very right and proper, for it is the struggle for existence that produces the selection of the fittest."
This is obviously a contradiction. On the one hand, he's against Christianity, so he's not a Christian. Yet, on the other, he's believing in Providence, which is defined as divine guidance. So, he's not an atheist either. And he's also not a pagan, because he only believes in one God, which is Providence, or the Lord. He doesn't refer to God as Allah or Buddha or whatever, so really, we're only left with Gnosticism or Hermeticism or something similar, which is why I'm favouring that argument.
And it's not something like Freemasonry, because he criticises that.
"I've realised one thing. The worst of Freemasonry is not so much the philosophic side as the fact that it's an immense enterprise of corruption. It's a handful of men who are responsible for the war."
He's not too concerned about the philosophic side of Freemasonry, probably because their philosophy, or their Gnostic religion, is really similar to what Hitler himself believes. So he can't really criticize them on that, he has to blame their corruption. And I wanted to bring that quote up because he normally blames the Jews for the war. In fact, he actually blames them a couple of paragraphs later. So here we have a direct contradiction in the exact same source, literally a couple of paragraphs apart, where he blames the Freemasons, but also the Jews. And I wanted to show this because if this was a forgery, why would they put such a blatantly obvious error in it like that? It doesn't make sense to do that. More likely, Hitler was just spitballing, saying a bunch of random stuff, and then made a mistake. That seems the most probable situation, and this lends credence to the idea that this is a genuine source.
On the day when the English set free their 9,000 fascists, these men will tear the guts out of the plutocrats, and the problem will be solved. In my view, when there are 9,000 men in a country who are capable of facing prison from loyalty to an idea, this idea remains a living one, and as long as a man is left to carry the flag, nothing is lost. Faith moves mountains. In that respect, I see things with the coldest objectivity. If the German people lost its faith, if the German people were no longer inclined to give itself body and soul in order to survive, then the German people would have nothing to do but disappear.
Again, it's all about the faith. It's a religion. Now, let's dispel the idea that Hitler was a pagan.
The observatory I'll have built at Linz on the Postlinburg, I can see it in my mind, a facade of quite classical purity. I'll have the pagan temple razed to the ground and the observatory will take its place. Thus, in future, thousands of excursionists will make a pilgrimage there every Sunday. They'll thus have access to the greatest of our universe. The pediment will bear this motto: "The heavens proclaim the glory of the everlasting." It will be our way of giving men a religious spirit, of teaching them humility, but without the priests. The science is a religion, apparently, but that motto, "The heavens proclaim the glory of the everlasting," is that the everlasting universe, or is it the everlasting soul that has been reconnected with the true God? Maybe I'm reading too much into it, but either way, it's an interesting quote. Man seizes hold here and there of a few scraps of truth, but he couldn't rule nature. He must know that, on the contrary, he is dependent on creation.
And I want to point out here that the capital C in creation is in the source. I'm not adding that in there, that's what they've put in there themselves. So man is dependent on capital C creation, which of course is divine creation.
And this attitude leads further than the superstitions maintained by the church.
So it's probable that Hitler had a different creation idea to Christianity. Maybe it's the Gnostic creation myth instead. And it's at this point that he starts talking about science, and then mentions world ice theory, where everything is made of ice. All matter is ice. And I'm not going to go there. Then, a few days later, he says this:
"I believe that Providence gives the victory to the man who knows how to use the brains nature has given him. I shall never come personally to terms with the Christian lie. In acting as I do, I'm very far from the wish to scandalize, but I rebel when I see the very idea of Providence flouted in this fashion. As far as I'm concerned, I act according to my convictions. I don't prevent anyone from praying silently. But I rebel against blasphemy."
Why would he be against blasphemy if he's not religious or Christian?
"So let nobody waste prayers on me that I shall not have asked for. If my presence on earth is providential, I owe it to a superior will, but I owe nothing to the church that traffics in the salvation of souls, and I find it really too cruel. I admit that one cannot impose one's will by force, but I have a horror of people who enjoy inflicting sufferings on others' bodies and tyranny upon others' souls."
So he does believe in human souls, and that these are separate from our bodies, because he says this several times.
"Our epoch will certainly see the end of the disease of Christianity. It will last another 100 years, 200 years perhaps. My regret will have been that I couldn't, like whoever the prophet was, behold the promised land from afar. We are entering into a conception of the world that will be a sunny era, an era of tolerance. Man must be put in a position to develop freely the talents that God has given him.
Again, he believes in God, just not the Christian God, and he doesn't like Christianity. Now, I could keep going on with the quotes, but I think I've given enough here today to make my point. Obviously, my current view is that Hitler is some kind of Gnostic. However, I am aware that there are counter-arguments. People were objecting to this in the previous video, and will no doubt do the same today, and I've found a quote that potentially could be used to counter this argument. So I will address those criticisms and talk about that quote in a future video. As I said last time, I haven't touched upon Heraclitus, the life laws or struggle, and a load of other stuff. You know, I mean, I've opened the door to something pretty huge here, and I can see this being a series of videos, because there's no way I can cover all this in a couple of videos, so let me know what you guys think. Is what I've provided so far convincing? Where should I go with it next? You guys let me know, and I'll see what I can do. So, thanks for watching. Bye for now.